6:30.
We are at ringside in Phoenix, Arizona, the Arizona Veterans Memorial Coliseum, and the tail of the tape shows the experience to Lopez, 27 years of age, and Danny Lopez, 42 wins, 3 losses, 39 knockouts. Salvador Sanchez, 30 wins, 1 loss, and 1 draw, according to Ring Magazine, 23 knockouts. He stands just an inch shorter than Danny Lopez, and as we commented earlier, that will be something different for Lopez, who has been usually the clearly taller man in his previous fight. He was born in 1952 in Fort Duchesne, Utah, as a Mexican father and an Irish Ute Indian mother. He lives now in the San Gabriel Valley in California. His wife Bonnie is here at ringside, and he has 3 boys of his own. Salvador Sanchez turned 21 just a week ago from the small town of Santiago Fianduestrego in Mexico, now lives in Mexico City. And he is ranked number 1. Certainly his most impressive fight, Angelo, was against Bel Clemente back last June in San Antonio. The referee is Valdemar Schmidt from San Juan, Puerto Rico. The scoring will be done by 3 judges at ringside: Lou Filippo from Downing, California, Chuck Hassett from Anaheim, California, and Jorge Velasco from Guadalajara, Mexico. Scoring here in Arizona is on the 10-point must system. There is a mandatory 8 count in effect. There is no 3 knockdown rule, and the count will continue after the bell, except in the final 15th round. The fighters will be wearing 8-ounce Reyes gloves. This is a 16-foot ring, and Angelo, will the ring be an advantage for the punching Danny Lopez?
Well, I'd have to say so, because he can come across this ring in a couple of strides, and he looks like he's ready to go. They've both been warming up very hard in the dressing room. This is going to be a dangerous first round.
Danny Lopez will be coming from the corner on the left. And we're underway with first round action scheduled for 15, the WBC Featherweight Championship. And for Danny Lopez, his 9th title defense, is winning it back in November of 76.
First round's been always a dangerous round for Danny Lopez, believe it or not. But he gets nailed with real tough shots, and this fella is a puncher. It's going to be a dangerous first round for Danny Lopez.
4 times he has been knocked down early in the fight, first or second round, and each time he's gotten up to win. Good right hand and a scoring combination from Sanchez, and a left hook land. Sanchez with remarkable poise for a 21-year-old. He really looks like a very mature young man.
That he is, and I don't like the way Danny Lopez just stood there and took the shot. I think he's trying to outpsych the kid, but he's getting hit with really tough shots.
Well, Mike Ayala landed several to Danny Lopez over 15 rounds, and he survived it.
But he was no puncher. This kid is a puncher, but he's got the height and the leverage to hurt Danny Lopez.
5'7" Salvador Sanchez, 5'8" Danny Lopez. 126 pounds. The featherweight limit.
Very dangerous for Red Lopez right now, Tim. I don't like the way he's reacting. He's getting hit with punches. He's covered it slowly. If this kid goes out for a very liable to get lucky and win this title right in the first round.
Sanchez has certainly been the aggressor and has scored heavily. Lopez showing no signs of damage. We're under a minute to go in the first round. Good start for the challenger, Sanchez.
Sanchez is fighting so far a very smart fight, not going crazy, landing his shots, and not gambling where he's going to get hit himself.
Good right, short, sharp right from Sanchez, scoring to the cheek of Lopez, the champion. Less than 30 seconds to go. Very composed, very contained young man. Good on his feet, as you can see, in close punches and combinations. Final second of his first round.
You've come to fly before the wind, harnessed to a wildcat,
leaving the rest of the world behind. So you go for it. You go for all the gusto you can get.
All right, this is round two from the Veterans Memorial Coliseum in Phoenix. Tim Ryan, Angelo Dundee, and Dick Stockton here to bring you this featherweight championship. A good first round for Salvador Sanchez, the challenger.
Last punch of the round, Tim. Danny Lopez really got hurt, lost his equilibrium, walking back to the corner. Really got hurt with the right hand.
Lopez in the black trunks. The top of your screen, Sanchez, a 21-year-old challenger from Mexico City, now on the left in white. Lopez is always exciting.
He's what you call Mr. Excitement, because he comes in there, it's either you or him.
39 knockouts and his 42 victories. Good right hand from Sanchez again lands. Lopez has yet to really score a tough punch. More of this kind of boxing action on CBS. Three more fights this month of February. We'll be in Portland, Maine for Marvin Hagler and Lucy Pomani on February 16th.
Sanchez is moving around real well away from the right hand, which is smart. And he's hurting Lopez.
Good left hook by Sanchez landed just before that last exchange. Very intense. Sees his target well.
Sanchez also an excellent body puncher with that left hook to the body. But what I like about it, he's moving away from Lopez's right hand.
He's in superb physical condition. He has his own personal physician who attends all his workouts, takes his pulse rate and heart rate at the end of each round of sparring. Very unusual training regimen. Good start left again. Less than a minute remaining, round two.
The mistake Sanchez can't afford to make is trade punches with Lopez, because that's when he can hurt you.
Trained by Benny Giorgino as Jackie McCoy in the corner as well. Good uppercut from Lopez. His first real good punch of the fight. We're in round two. Now a combination from Lopez. Ben Sanchez back to the rope. Lopez coming on here near the end of round two. We're in the final second with Lopez landing the combination. The crowd coming to its feet.
RCA wants you to see the right color. Can your television...
The bell for round three. Danny Lopez, the champion, on the left of your screen. Salvador Sanchez, on the right, has started awfully well. Lopez finally coming on near the end of round two.
Near the end of that last round, Sanchez made his first mistake. He started gambling with Indian Red Lopez. You should play cat and mouse game and don't gamble with Lopez. It's the worst thing you can do.
Referee Valdemar Schmidt asking the Sanchez corner to clean up the water. They used quite a bit between rounds, and now they're reaching in to soak some of it up. It can be dangerous. I'd like to slip on that. 16-foot ring. Sanchez would like to use all of it. He moves awfully well.
Sanchez is starting to box more. He must do that to win this fight, because you're not going to win a title fight fighting with a Danny Red Lopez, because that's his game.
We talked about Sanchez's excellent physical condition. Of course, Lopez, one of the great training fighters, bounced around and worked real hard in training. He landed a right hand to the ear of Sanchez. Sanchez snuck in a right hand lead, first we've seen. Three rounds from Sanchez. Combination by Lopez scores. Right hand from Lopez.
Sanchez can't let his Mexican hands out. He's got to play a cat and mouse game. Fox, don't trade with Lopez, or he's going to get knocked out.
Well, we've seen the usual slow start by Lopez. Sanchez dominating the first two rounds. But Lopez did not go down.
Lopez just sustained a cut over his right eye. Doesn't look bad, but it just opened up.
Right hand landed. His blood from the nose of Sanchez. Man remaining in round number three. Tim Ryan, Angelo Dundee, Dick Stockton, and Phoenix. Live on the CBS Sports Spectacular. Three more fights later this month. February 16th, Hagler Hamadi, middleweight. Howard David, Vilomar Fernandez, big lightweight bout on February 23rd. And then the next day, Mike Rossman and Ramon Ranclao, light heavyweight.
So Sanchez must have been listening because he's starting to move. That's the way you got to fight Lopez. You can't stay there with him. But Lopez is a dynamite puncher.
Short fight from Lopez. Landing to the skin. Sanchez did not have a whole lot on it. Final seconds of this third round.
Billy the Kid, Wyatt Earp, Jesse James.
Round four, Danny Lopez getting attention for a slight cut over his right eyebrow.
Yeah, Jackie McCoy did a good job of stopping the cut. It's right on top of the eyebrow. It's not a serious plate on the top of the right eye.
Right hand lead from Lopez. Sanchez scores with the right hand. Sanchez with 23 knockouts and 30 victories. Lopez, 39 KOs and 42 wins.
That swelling under the left eye of Lopez is more dangerous than the cut, actually, Tim, because it's starting to swell, and it's on the bottom and starting to close the eye.
Lopez going to the body. Again. Sanchez backed up Lopez, left hook, right hand again.
Red Lopez is hurt for the first time. First time I see him get hurt.
Lopez takes another combination from Sanchez. Sanchez keeps him on the rope. Looks like a cut on the nose now of Danny Lopez, the champion. Unless that blood came down from above. We'll watch it.
That's the worst physical condition I've seen Lopez in a long time. This kid is a real good puncher, Tim, and he really hurt Lopez that last exchange.
Still a calm, cool, collected Sanchez showing a remarkable poise, 21 years of age. Against the veteran champion who's 27. A minute remaining, round four.
Blood coming from the nose of Lopez now. That right uppercut did that, Jim. And the cheekbone swelling some more also. Real tough, tough exchange.
Sanchez appears unmarked. Sanchez throwing them well, very straight. Little blood from the nose of Sanchez. Lopez leading from that cut above the eyebrow, also from the nose. Final seconds of the fourth round, a grueling first four rounds with the champion taking most of the punishment.
How do you spell relief?
When I get acid indigestion, I spell relief.
From that fourth round, Lopez and Sanchez and Salvador Sanchez really going to work on the champion.
Notice how they both look the same height, Tim? That right uppercut was a devastating punch that kid threw right here.
All right, we're back live now. Round five. Tim Ryan and Angelo Dundee at ringside. The featherweight championship of the world. Danny Lopez. His ninth title defense. Last defended it in September with a third-round knockout of Jose Cabot, but he's in against a much stronger opponent.
Well, he's in real bad trouble, Tim. He's got to come up with the best survival test of all time to go. This kid is hurting with every punch now.
Another combination landing by Sanchez.
This kid is fighting a very smart, calculated fight. He's going in and out and moving away from Lopez. That's the way he's got to fight him. Cat and mouse game to win.
There is a cut on the nose of Danny Lopez, one over the right eyebrow, and he is also bleeding from the nose. Left hook from Sanchez lands. The referee is Waldemar Schmidt, scoring is done by three judges. Referee is not a participant in the story.
The only way Sanchez is going to lose this fight, Tim, is if he fights him and he trades punches with the guy. If he keeps giving Lopez movement in and out, he can't lose the title. He'll be a new champion.
Well, watching him work out this week, that's what he seemed to be working on, lots of movement. Sanchez, and he's good with his feet. We saw that against El Clemente.
Lopez is changing his attack. He's going downstairs, then on top. Very smart move he did right then with the right hand to the body.
Five scheduled for 15, live on the CBS Sports Spectacular.
Left eye's cut, Tim. Above the left eye, just cut right open.
Angelo already pointed out the swelling under the left eye, so now Lopez with a severe problem around his left eye. We're under a minute to go in round five. The champion has been able to land very few solid punches to Sanchez. Even that flurry did not do any real damage as Sanchez got back into the corner for the first time. It came out unmarked. 30 seconds remaining in the fifth round.
Before you buy a new car, please know this. Oldsmobile is America's number.
This is round six of the featherweight championship fight. Co-promotion here of five-star promotions out of Los Angeles at Madison Square Garden. And they're putting on quite a show so far. Sanchez and Lopez. Sugar Ray Leonard is in attendance, sitting right next to us here at ringside. Welterweight champ. Former welterweight champion Tony DeMarco lives here in Phoenix. Also in attendance, along with the governor of the state, Bruce Babbitt.
Salvatore.
Right hand from Sanchez. That rocked him.
Fighting a great fight. Smart fight. He just can't, you know, get too cocky, because that's a mark of a kid, a young 21-year-old kid. He's having everything his own way. He's winning the fight, but he's got to fight a cat and mouse game. He's got to move. He's not moving enough right now. He's been well schooled, Tim. He's
sure has.
Hands up around his head, looking to block the right hand with the left hand high. He's fighting a perfect fight so far.
His manager is Cristobal Rosas, trained by Enrique Huerta and Rosas. And he has been well trained. I like the way he really sees his target. He just keeps his eye and sees every punch he throws. He knows where it's going.
Well, he's got to make sure, because one good shot from Red Lopez, you know, and the ball game might be over, Tim.
That is always the possibility with the great champion Lopez. Sanchez blocked Lopez back once more with a left hand.
Lopez has got to take the heart out of everybody, because the shots he's getting hit and not going down could discourage anyone.
Mike Ayala gave him such a great fight. Went the distance into the 15th round, and finally Lopez able to finish him off, as Miguel and Ayala suffered a broken nose earlier in that fight.
But Tim, I guarantee him, Salvador Sanchez knocked out many a man with the shot he's hit Lopez with, and Lopez is not going down.
We're under a minute to go in round six. Blood from that cut over the right eye of Lopez streaming down his face. Good combination from Lopez. Lopez's best punch of the fight, a left hand that rocked the head back of Salvador Sanchez. Now the referee wants to have Lopez cut examined by the ringside doctor. That is Dr. Lake coming in. The time counting down here in the sixth round. Dr. Lake will examine the cut over the left eye of Danny Lopez.
Benny Giordino tried to make a move and say, what was it, a butt? Which is a smart move for a master to make. It was a punch, but not a butt.
All right. Dr. Lake has given Lopez the okay to continue. The round timer has counted down, so we're depending on the official timekeeper. There were about 10 seconds left in the round, as we recall it from looking up, and Sanchez trying to finish off the champion. Now the referee is...
Whatever I'm into, I like to move fast. An English leather stick deodorant made
for... Round six came to a conclusion after the doctor examined Danny Lopez and allowed him to continue. Let's look at some of that last flurry of the sixth round. As the clock here showed zeros, but the official timekeeper had the count after the clock had continued to run when the referee stopped it for the examination of Lopez's left eye. And we're now ready for round number seven. Salvador Sanchez has done a job on Danny Lopez. It'll be really something if the champion can come back to win this.
Well, it's remarkable. But I tell you, I don't like the way Sanchez got hit near the end of the round, Timmy. He got hurt with two punches. So he can't fight with Lopez if he's going to get knocked out. Got to be very careful.
Danny Lopez has never finished until he's finished. He's lost only three times. He's gotten up off the canvas four times. Sanchez must know that. Lopez on the attack, somewhat desperately here in round seven. And Sanchez willing to trade punches with him now. That might not be the right thing to do, Andy.
Oh, that's a mistake. He's definitely got to keep the game plan up. Box, move. Don't get hit. Play cat and mouse.
Your card, he's got five of the first six rounds.
The cut over the right eye has really gotten bad, Timmy. It's open, wide open.
Like Jack, to remind our stations, Andy, we're going to a station break at the end of this seventh round.
Salvador Sanchez's cut over the left eye.
Blood is streaming from a cut in the corner. But Sanchez's left eye, and still he's trading punches with Lopez, and he snaps him back with a straight left. Tremendous action in this featherweight championship fight. Almost guaranteed by Danny Lopez. Salvador Sanchez showing what a great challenger he is. He can smell the title.
One thing great about Lopez, he always fights number one. He's been a great champion.
Sanchez is the number one rated WBC contender from Mexico City. Right hand from Sanchez. Scott Lopez coming in on the attack. Minute to go in round seven.
Timmy's hit him with a great right hand counter. He's catching the right hand with the glove and countered with his own right hand.
Lopez has punched over both eyes now, and again, Baltimore Smith has called for the ring physician, Dr. Lick, to examine him. Now this time they have stopped the clock. 47 seconds remaining is on the scoreboard clock here. 47 seconds remaining in round seven. Sanchez getting a breather in his corner. Dr. Lake has allowed the champion to continue once more. And the time starts to tick. 40 seconds remaining in the seventh round. A tremendous featherweight championship fight. Less than 30 seconds remaining, and a combination from Sanchez scores. Like We'd like to alert our stations that we will hold on that station break. We're going to stay here following round seven.
Lopez was hurt for the first time badly on last exchange. He's hurt again.
Good right hand from Sanchez. Final seconds of the seventh round. Stay with the stations along the line. Lopez bleeding from cuts over both eyes and battling full energy in round seven. Sanchez again calmly to his corner, and let's look at Danny Lopez in his corner as Benny Giorgino, Jackie McCoy will work feverishly over him. He's in trouble, obviously.
Oh, he's in all kinds of trouble. His cuts are varied. They're on either side of his face. Jackie McCoy's really got a tough job to get that cut.
The last part of round number seven, we're going to show you again here. And Salvador Sanchez has just been landing those kind of punches, effectively, particularly with the right hand, but he throws that left almost as well.
He really got hurt that last shot. I was worried about that, you know what I mean? But I never seen him take an effective punch like that and wobble like that. He really did wobble.
You can see the swelling under his left eye. Cuts over both eyes. Twice he has been examined in round six and in round seven by the ring physician. The cut's not severe enough to prevent him from continuing. And we're ready for round number eight. Now, barring anything unusual, we'll go to our station break at the end of round eight. Alerting our stations along the line on the CBS Television Network, live on the CBS Sports Spectacular today, a tremendously exciting featherweight championship fight. The champion on the right in black, the challenger, Sanchez, on the left in white, 21 years of age. What a job he's doing. The ever-dangerous Danny Lopez could turn this fight around with one punch, but he's well behind.
The difference is this kid is fighting the fight. He's tall. He's moving away. He's not giving him a chance to land the big bomb. And he's staying off the ropes. He's fighting a good, calculated, smart fight.
We talked about the height being almost equal. First time Danny's faced anybody that tall as a champion. How much of an effect has it had?
Big effect. He's not reaching with the right hand. He's a tall guy, and the right hand's going right over the top.
How much effect do you think that grueling 15-rounder against Mike Ayala had on Lopez?
We said before, it didn't do him no good. Those kind of fights are long-distance fights where you're taking your licking. It'll do nobody no good.
Sanchez has never been 15 rounds. He's been 12 rounds twice, once for the Mexican championship, his only loss against Becerra, and then against Bel Clemente, the elimination fight that got him here. He won that one. Round number eight. Grueling fight for the champion, Danny Lopez.
Sanchez is keeping his cool real good, Tim. He's moving around. He's doing the right thing. He's got to keep fighting that kind of fight.
We've got Sugar Ray Leonard here at ringside. And if we can open our other microphone, we'll just get a comment from the champion here on this fight. Sugar Ray, this is something.
I'm very surprised with Sanchez. He's taking his time. He's fighting like a real professional, a veteran. He hurt Lopez with a lot of combinations, but he's really taking his time and pacing himself very well.
You have to be impressed with a champion. Still solid in there after all the cuts and all the beating he's taken.
Well, Danny was staying there from 1 to 15 if you have to.
All right, Sugar Ray, thanks very much. Featherweight champion Sugar Ray sitting next to the man who manages him here, Angelo Dundee, our commentator. Under 30 seconds to go in round eight. We'll be going to a station break at the end of this round. Lopez, swollen under that left eye. It's starting to close on him, Angie.
Yes, it is. That's I was more concerned about the left eye than the right eye, actually.
Final seconds. We'll return to Phoenix after this word from our local station.
This is CBS. Tonight on TV2.
We're in round number nine, scheduled for 15, the WBC Featherweight Championship. The champion, Danny Lopez, dedicated this fight to one of the American hostages in Iran. Sergeant Lopez from nearby Globe, Arizona, no relation. A young man he dedicated his Ayala fight to, Ruben Mendoza from San Antonio. A young cancer patient is here at ringside as a guest of Danny Lopez, the champion is not only a great fighter, he's a fine young person and a great humanitarian. The Lopez family is here also. The father of Marine Sergeant Lopez, the parents of Marine Sergeant Lopez, is Danny's guest for the fight. I'm sure they're hoping he can pull out the big one here. He's their favorite, obviously. The champion is really facing an uphill struggle against Salvador Sanchez.
Well, yes, he is. And he's going to have to come out with everything he's got here. And I don't think it's there. I think the well ran dry because he can't even take the offensive on this kid, but he's moving him around.
Round. There is some blood from the nose of Sanchez. Not at all serious. He had a slight cut in the corner of his left eye, but that doesn't seem to be bothering him at all. Look at him, Jab, coming out the rope. Danny Lopez's face is painted with blood.
Lopez changed his tactics. He's going downstairs. He's got to do that. He's got to stop this kid from being so fleet on his feet. If he hurts him with a couple of body shots, he'll be able to reach him that much easier.
Are you surprised he hasn't gone to the body more?
Well, the kid is trying to put the perfect fight, Sanchez.
Sanchez is also hard to hit, hard to get a good lick in. But good movement. Minute remaining in round 9. Referee is Valdemar Schmidt. He will not participate in the scoring if this goes the distance. Three judges at ringside will do that on the 10-point must system.
Looks like it's going to get worse, Tim. Lopez just can't seem to get on track. This kid got his number.
The 9th title defense for 27-year-old champion Danny the Little Red Lopez.
This is the only way the kid can lose the fight, doing just what he just did. Trade with him. He can lose the fight easily that way.
Got more action like this on the Sports Spectacular. Three more fights coming up. February 16th, Marvin Hagler and Lucy Fermani. That's our next one. We'll be back with the 10th round here in a moment.
A message from Exxon. This year, Exxon plans to spend more than $6.5 billion to find...
Number 10, scheduled for 15. And the challenger, Salvador Sanchez, has had his way close to this fight. On our cards, we've given only 2 to Lopez. Sanchez scoring with a combination. Lopez apparently can still see out of that left eye. There is a lot of swelling underneath.
This is going to be the home stretch, Tim. This is going to see if this kid can go. He's been 12.
He's been 12.
Going with a tough pace like he's going with Lopez is a big difference fighting 12 with some other guys.
Well, we mentioned the unusual training regimen in which his own personal doctor checks his pulse and heart rate. At the end of each round of sparring, boy, they really monitor this young man neurologically as well. And they say he is in absolutely perfect condition. Couldn't be better. And ready to go 15. Right hand to the cheekbone of Lopez from Sanchez. Another one. Lopez just keeps coming at you. It has to be frustrating, although Sanchez hasn't shown any signs of the frustration.
Lopez keeps that left hand flashing through his head. We've got to keep doing that because we're getting hit with some right hand shots now.
Lopez just stalking, trying to put a couple together that'll send the challenger to the canvas. Blood from the cut over the right eye of Lopez starting to scream again.
This is Lopez's best round so far, Tim. He's starting to put some hurt on Sanchez. You know, Tim, it's funny. When they first made this match, they said Salvador who? But Mickey Davis was a smart matchmaker. The five-star promotion of the club with a great show.
That is for sure. And he is ranked number 1 by the WBC. And he is showing why in this fight.
Lopez can't wait on this kid because he's going to just take a bad licking all night long. You got to go and try to gamble and go for broke.
Under a minute to go in round 10. Another combination scoring from Sanchez. Lopez started this round very well. Under 30 seconds, he takes a short, sharp, straight right.
Lopez is starting to get hurt with those shots, Tim, now. He's starting to, you know, wobble. Last right hand he got hit, he was doing tricks with his knees that time. And that's a sign of getting hurt.
Approaching the end of the 10th round, Danny Lopez, the featherweight champion, Salvador Sanchez, the challenger.
From the people who brought you the Workmate comes the incredible bench top. You can put it on a table or clamp it to your chest.
Round 11, 15-round championship fight. Danny Lopez at the top of your screen, circling to the right now. Salvador Sanchez from Mexico City. February 16th here on CBS, we'll have an outstanding middleweight bout. Marvin Hagler fought that controversial draw against the champion, Vito Anafermo. He'll be taking on a tough Frenchman, Lucie Tamani from Portland, Maine. February 23rd, Howard Davis and Vilomar Fernandez, lightweight elimination. February 24th, the next day, also from Atlantic City, light heavyweight, Ramon Rampueo and Mike Rossman in a rematch. And right here, Dick Stockton, Angelo Dundee, Tim Ryan, all at ringside for this great championship fight, Lopez and Sanchez.
Lopez continues to amaze me how he can stay in there and take the punches he's taking. He's a tremendously well-conditioned young man. Body strength is unquestionable. I just don't think he can take too many a licking like this and continue on.
Well, he's in round number 11, and he just keeps coming straight ahead. But it has been Sanchez, except for the last couple of rounds. Lopez has started to turn it around a little bit, but he's not been able to hurt Sanchez. Some blood from the cut over the left eye of Lopez that he suffered early in the fight.
Long as Sanchez keeps moving either side of Lopez, he's in no danger. The first time he goes straight back, then he's going to get nailed with a right-hand shot. If he goes straight back, he's going to get hit.
Right-hand lead landed from Sanchez. Well, he commented that he does have good movement, so if he was following your advice, he'd be using it. Going left and going right.
Well, that's what he's doing.
And he can do it. He's
giving him movement.
Very poised young man from Mexico City. Went off to a ranch outside of that city in Mexico to train for this big opportunity. Right hand lead from Sanchez, snap back to head of Lopez.
But 12 more minutes to go, and Sanchez for the first time is starting to reach with his punches. That could be very dangerous for the Lopez.
Sanchez with Lopez in his corner, in the Sanchez corner, trying to finish him here. Look at this youngster shrug. Dangerous territory against Danny Lopez, but Sanchez fighting with a lot of confidence. Final second of the 11th round. What a great fight, as usual, from Danny Lopez.
Oldsmobile's restyled Delta 88 has a very nice look and a very nice sound.
Next week, you'll be seeing the great speed skaters Eric and Beth Hyden and all of the top Soviets as well, and our speed skating coverage from West Dallas, Wisconsin. Dick Stockton will be there on the Sports Spectacular. All right, we're in round number 12 of this featherweight championship fight. The challenger, Sanchez, on the right of your screen. The champion, Lopez, on the left in black.
Sanchez will know he's got more than 9 more minutes to go, because Lopez is going to be trying everything he can do, because he's a great champion and he feels his title slipping away on him.
Round 12, this is as far as Sanchez has gone. Lopez has been the distance before.
It's a lot to ask of a 21-year-old youngster to be moving like he's doing what he's doing. Now he's trying to lay a little bit, rest a little bit. Can't do that.
Landed a good short right again. Lopez has just not been able to put any sustained attack on Sanchez. He hasn't even been able to land two consecutive punches that have hurt Sanchez or set him back.
Hurt Lopez with a great left hook, Tim.
He knew it, and he's on the attack. Lopez is covering up well. I want him on the rope. Blood again from the cut over the right eye of Lopez.
That's the first time in a long time I see Lopez move away with a slugging match against the ropes. He usually makes the opponent get out of there.
A lot of blood from that cut over the right eye. Referee Schmidt has twice stopped the fight momentarily to have those cuts examined back in round 6 and 7.
I don't think the cut is really substance, Tim, because it's in an area where it's not bothering his vision. It's those punches he's taking which is bothering the referee.
We're under a minute to go in round 12.
This has been a great fight, Tim.
Another terrific fight.
But you expect it with a Lopez.
Yes,
whenever he goes to the bat. To me, he's a promoter's dream, a fight fan dream.
He really is, and that's not to take any credit away from Sanchez, who is winning the fight in our cards. He obviously has done as much as Danny to make this a great fight. But Lopez just always guarantees a great show. Final seconds of the 12th round.
This far, this fast.
Round 13 live on the CBS Sports Spectacular from Phoenix, Arizona, and the challenger comes out swinging.
Sanchez come back with another right hand right on his chin.
Another good job in the Lopez corner as he comes out with his cuts looking pretty good here. And Sanchez, of course, will be banging away at them throughout this round. Solid right hand from Sanchez. He's now teeing off on that right hand lead, Andy.
That light, the left eye, he can't see the right hand coming, actually, Tim.
Good point, because he just took another one, and we had a good look at it.
Can't see it coming.
That eye nearly closed, Danny Lopez's left eye.
He's got trouble looking from that eye. He just gets smart enough to take advantage of it.
He is hurt, isn't he?
He's hurt. Really hurt.
Hurt. Sanchez, the referee's going to stop it. The referee's going to stop it. That's it. There is a new featherweight world champion, WBC version, Salvador Sanchez, from Mexico City, as referee Valdemar Schmidt has stopped the fight in the 13th round after a hard right hand staggered Lopez, followed up with a flurry by Sanchez, and that was enough. Let's take a look at the last flurry again, see if we can pick out that one key punch. That one hurt him.
The right hand did the whole job, Tim.
It was that punch indeed, because it backed up Lopez. The referee, Schmidt, did a good job saying, hey, that's enough for this great champion. Salvador Sanchez, 21 years of age from Mexico City, is the new WBC featherweight champion. And will return here to Phoenix in just a moment.
Detroit is justifiably proud of its reputation as a Renaissance city and a meeting place of the world.
The new WBC featherweight champion of the world from Mexico, Salvador Sanchez, in a big upset win. The question is, how can a 21-year-old fight such a brilliant fight strategically? Combinations with the right uppercut, then moving away and slipping away from what Danny Lopez had.
Como un chamaco tan joven puede pelear tan brillante, usando combinaciones, rapidez y golpe.
Bueno, yo creo que es a base de preparación, de inteligencia y sobre todo de la buena administración que mi licenciado y todo el equipo que me respalda.
Number one, in good condition, the confidence that he had, the good training, and above all, his administration.
All right, were you surprised that he did come back after the doctor looked at the cut the first time and he came back with a flurry?
Y si te sorprendió cuando el doctor lo dejó seguir la pelea después de las cortadas.
Sí, sí, me sorprendió porque en cualquier otro lugar que no fuera aquí, yo pienso que en México lo hubieran parado de inmediato.
He says that in any other place, they would have stopped the fight. Any other place, with the cut that he had, they would have stopped the fight.
What was your strategy going in?
Era tus planes entrar a la pelea.
Boxearlo así, con rapidez, sin quedarse en las cuerdas, y sobre todo con inteligencia.
With a lot of intelligence, staying off the ropes and boxing.
For 21 years, that's tremendous. National hero of Mexico, isn't he?
Right. Nacional, héroe nacional de México.
¿Mandé?
Que eres un héroe nacional en tu país.
Sí, soy héroe nacional. Quiero enviar un saludo.
Salvador Sanchez is our champion here in Phoenix, Arizona, in a brilliant fight, and we'll be back with more from Memorial Coliseum in just a moment.
I am here to remind you to do something you've meant to do with that.
By the way, Salvador Sanchez was ahead on all three cards when the fight was stopped in the 13th round of a scintillating fight here in Phoenix. Don't forget the Bing Crosby, Pebble Beach Golf follows next. NBA All-Star Game comes tomorrow from Landover, Maryland, and next Saturday and Sunday on the CBS Sports Spectacular, the world comes to West Allis, Wisconsin for the World Sprint Skate Speed Championship with Eric and Beth Hyden. The Soviets will be there as well. It'll be a big event next week on the Sports Spectacular. Right here, you saw Salvador Sanchez unseat Danny Little Red Lopez in a thrilling fight for the WBC Featherweight Championship. So, till we see you next week in West Allis, for Angelo Dundee and Tim Ryan, this is Dick Stockton saying so long for the CBS Sports Spectacular.
For the CBS Sports Spectacular, executive producer Eddie Einhorn, coordinating producer Ed Gorin.
Felix Trinidad, who possesses one of the highest knockout ratios in boxing today at 86%, averaging just under four rounds per bout. So a friendly reminder, don't go to the fridge. He's had seven first-round knockouts, nine straight KOs prior to meeting Hector Camacho in 94, 9-0 with eight knockouts in world title fights. And keep in mind, he's only 23. He began his championship run with a devastating second-round KO of two-time world champ Maurice Blocker in 1993. The very loose Felix Trinidad. Let's see how they stack up on paper as we check out the tail of the tape. Immediately, you notice the disparity in age. At 33, Pendleton, 10 years older than Trinidad. Trinidad has a 2.5-inch height advantage, both tipping the scales at the contract weight of 147, and the reach almost even. IBF rules for this world championship bout. Scoring is under the 10-point must. Three judges score the fight. No standing eight count. No three knockdown rule. Only the referee can stop the fight. A fighter cannot be saved by the bell in any round. If an accidental foul occurs before the end of the sixth round, it is ruled a no decision. If it happens after the completion of the sixth, they go to the scorecards. Only completed rounds are scored. So here at the Grand Ballroom of the Mirage Hotel in Las Vegas, we are closing in on our main event, the IBF Welterweight Championship. It is unbeaten. Felix Trinidad versus Freddie Pendleton, set for the pre-fight ceremonies. Here's our ring announcer, the classy Jimmy Lennon Jr.
Well, fans, before we present our main event of the evening, we bring to your attention that, as always, a donation of $5,000 will be made by Don King Productions and Showtime. And it will be made to the United Negro College Fund, the National Hispanic Scholarship Fund, and the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. This donation will be made in the name of the fighter of the night, who will be selected by an expert panel of judges at the conclusion of tonight's action. Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening, and we welcome you to our featured attraction of the evening right here at the beautiful Mirage Resort in Las Vegas. It is all brought to you by Don King Productions and the Mirage, along with La Cerveza Más Fina Corona. This bout coming your way is sanctioned by the International Boxing Federation, the President Robert Lee Sr., Supervisor Daryl Peoples, along with the Nevada State Athletic Commission. The chairman is Dr. James Nave, commissioners Nat Carasali, Dr. Elias Gonham, Luther Mack, and Crispin Rivera. The executive director, Mark Ratner. Physicians at ringside, Dr. Flip Pomansky, Dr. James Jane, Dr. Margaret Goodman, and Dr. Gino Signorino. Timekeepers at the bell, also keeping count of the knockdowns. We have Al Bicek and Jane Broadfoot. Introducing our judges, scoring this bout from ringside, Mike Gliena, Glenn Hamada, and Jerry Roth. All right, fans, here we go. And now, ladies and gentlemen in attendance and boxing fans joining us around the world, it's showtime! With the IBF Welterweight Championship of the World scheduled for 12 rounds of boxing, introducing our referee in charge of this bout, working in this his 132nd world title bout, Richard Steele. Introducing to you first the challenger. On my right, he is fighting out of the blue corner. Entering the ring tonight, wearing blue trunks with silver trim and fighting out of Miami, Florida. He weighed in at the welterweight limit of 147 pounds. His deceptive record stands at 40 wins, 20 losses, and 4 draws, with 28 wins coming by way of knockout. He is ranked the number 2 IBF junior welterweight contender. Please welcome the former IBF lightweight champion of the world, known as Fearless, Freddie Pendleton. His opponent across the ring is the defending champion on my left, fighting out of the red corner, entering the ring wearing multicolored trunks, fighting out of and representing Cupejanto, Puerto Rico. He weighed in the same as his opponent, 147 pounds even. He is undefeated in his campaign in the ring with 28 wins, no losses, 24 big wins coming by way of knockout. Please welcome one of the young stars of boxing today, making his 9th defense of his title, introducing the undefeated IBF welterweight champion of the world, Felix Tito Trinidad. Once again, our referee in charge. Now to give instructions, we have Richard Steele.
Okay, I spoke to both fighters in the dressing room. I'm cautioning again. Obey my commands at all times. Is there any question? Shake hands and good luck.
Despite being 28-0 and 24 KOs and close to being considered a great champion, the chin of Felix Trinidad remains a question mark. He's been down, but never out. And Freddie Pendleton, he says he's very comfortable at this weight, telling us this is my weight, 147. He claims he lost the 135-pound title because of his weight. He says he got a raw deal against Rafael Ruelas. We'll see what happens here. He comes right out. Winging does Freddie Pendleton, the challenger.
He got nothing to lose. He said he's going to come out. He's got the heavy punch. And if this kid gets in trouble, if Trinidad kid gets in trouble, he'll finish him off. We'll see.
Trinidad says, because I've been knocked down doesn't mean I have a weak chin. Many great champions have been knocked down. Despite that, Pendleton at 33 with a less than impressive 40-24 record. A big underdog, even though he's a former lightweight champ.
You know, Pendleton's last fight, he fought at 148. And 4 or 5 fights over the past 2 years have been at 147. So he is not a stranger to this weight.
And he's comfortable at it. He doesn't have to make weight here. He's comfortable. So is Trinidad. I mean, Trinidad has no problem.
Trinidad feels that Pendleton will come out throwing bombs right from the outset. He calls him a serious opponent because of his experience and power, but talk is cheap. Trinidad says, I'm going to explode my bomb first. I don't think this will go to the distance.
Well, you can see that Tito has some respect for Frankie's power, because when he had no respect, like when he fought Camacho, he just ran through him, ran to him every chance he got. Here, he's being very careful, and he's not taking too many chances.
Well, he's got the example of what happened a few minutes ago right in this ring. But a last-minute knockout, so he knows it can happen to him in one punch. But that's not, I think the problem is more, and Freddie's fighting a little jinky. How can I say it? His eyes are a little bit wide open.
Well, 14 of Trinidad's last 15 fights did not go the distance. Only Camacho, as you point out, Bobby, has managed to reach the final bell with Felix Trinidad the last 5 years.
Freddie Pendleton has really come into his own over the past 4 or 5 years. He's actually been in the ring 12 champions, former world champions are current, two of them twice. He's had a list of who's who and who he's fought, and certainly he's lost a lot of them, but he's really come into his own, got a lot of confidence, he's punching better, he's moving better, and I'll tell you what, early on I like his chances to do very well.
He's a seasoned pro, lots of experience, very tough, good ability, hand speed, aggressive, dangerous, but many feel just not in the same class as Felix Trinidad.
Well, if his nickname's anything to go by, he shouldn't be scared, he should be fearless.
So I think at this weight, though, Tito's been here for a considerably longer period of time. He's comfortable. He's a big puncher at this weight. And I think that may be the difference, the strength, the youth, and the weight. Freddie's also 33.
Talent and being the championship has something to do with it, being a champion, because he fights with such confidence, Bobby. I mean, this guy's never tasted defeat.
20 seconds left for the opening round, scheduled for 12 for the IBF welterweight championship.
A very quiet opening count. Tito not opening up here.
Here's the first big punch that missed, and Fearless in his ever charismatic style says, hey, what happened there?
Taunting Trinidad a little bit, maybe get the young man out of his game.
Mira, mando para ahí, por favor.
Banqueta adelante, banqueta adelante.
La banqueta tiene que subir primero.
All he's saying is, this is his dad, Felix Trinidad, senior, the trainer.
Ya mismito va a empezar a llegar ese ya. No te cuides. Él va a seguir haciendo maromas, pero ya sé que él es un maromero padre, un macho, algo así más o menos. ¿Tú me entiendes? Pero ya mismito.
He comes forward. You see what he's trying to do? The thing we saw in the tape. He steps forward. You almost caught him. That'll get him, baby. You listen to me, that'll get him. Keep your hands up, get out small. Okay. Don't raise your head up. Okay. One more deep breath. Give me another one. Through the nose, out the mouth. It's your fight. It's your fight. You're faster, you're stronger.
Take him down.
One round of the books, the proverbial feeling out round, as there wasn't too much scoring going on. Here we go, round number two.
Yeah, that was about as uneventful as we could expect.
Trinidad basically fights every fight the same, hard and in dominating fashion. He feels more motivated now because now he's a target. He says he's just got too much at stake. He ended that first round with a wild punch that missed, and Fearless Freddie Pendleton tried to taunt him, but that's not going to affect Trinidad.
Pendleton was stopped by Frankie Randall way back in 85, once again in 88 by a guy named John Montes. But in the past 8 years, he has not been stopped, and he's fought some very, very credible opposition. He really has come into his own. I'm really anxious to see what he can put together here tonight.
I've seen him be aggressive, but not effectively aggressive, as in the Giovanni Parisi fight. I've seen him show tremendous heart and courage, too, as in the Darryl Tyson fight, no relation to Mike, for the USBA junior welterweight crown.
Just stuck his tongue out.
Well, he's got that flashy reputation in terms of demeanor, sticking out the tongue. Some feel he may have been humbled by the loss to Rafael Ruelas, but every once in a while he does that tongue thing, which is a huge turnoff to judges and fans and his trainer, Al Bonanni, from Miami. He says he realizes everybody hates it. It's a bad habit, but he says, I'm too quick to get hit.
Well, I don't know about too quick to get hit, but maybe too quick to get hit just while the tongue's out.
That's the midway point of round two. I think the only guy who can get away with that is Michael Jordan.
Yeah, nobody's trying to hit him. Right, they are, but they can't get up that high.
So they feel Freddie's a little quicker in his corner than Trinidad. Want him to get off first, use a jab, and time Trinidad coming out of some of those big punch combinations. We'll see what happens.
Freddie ought to be getting a little bit of confidence, but Trinidad has not come out here to wipe out the placement. He's fighting nice and calm. It's not like he's up here to eliminate him in a second, so he should be getting confident.
Here's the There's a straight right hand by Felix Trinidad, and the gesture as if to say, that's all you got for Freddie Pettle.
He said, for now. That's all we got for now. Later, more to come later. Now, that argument raged in whether the tongue sticking out was hanging. And he said, you know, I've never been hit yet. I said, when you do get hit, it is not going to be anything but stars and stripes, boy. You're going to see some stars.
Bobby, your instant analysis of Trinidad here in the early going.
Well, you know, right now Trinidad is a little bit pensive. He's a little bit careful, maybe a little too careful, but he's fighting what should be a smart fight. He's got to feel out the veteran. He's been in with a lot of opposition, 60-some-odd fights. He's got to be a little careful and work what he does best.
And this is dangerous as the challenger, Pendleton, going for the one-punch knockout there. Heading for the bell.
Open up.
Now let's stay back.
He's staying back, so you gotta have to make the fight a little bit more. You're doing good. You're trying to bait him.
Let's see that straight right hand whack, and now watch the tongue. Yeah. See, but that distance is so great, you couldn't bridge that with a gun.
No, he hit you with a right hand. The stinger, I'm telling you, he ain't got that much. Give me this. Deep breath. Keep your hands up. Every time he jabs, double jab him back.
Okay.
Every time he jabs, counter him back. Okay, with right hands and hooks. All right, you get off first, and if he jabs, you jab back.
When Al Bonanni just said he ain't got that much, Ferdy and I just looked at each other. Okay.
It was a contest to see whose eyebrows could go up any further.
Well, the corner part of their job is to kind of pump you up, and that's one way to do it.
Round three. Pendleton doesn't seem to be intimidated by Trinidad's speed or power. Well, Trinidad's one of those guys, Bobby, as you have pointed out in the past, he's not just a welterweight, he's a big welterweight, borderline junior middleweight at 154. He's 5'11", and he's full and he's thick.
He'll eventually be a full middleweight at least. Although, watch this round, you notice as we started, Pendleton's stepping in a little bit this time. Trinidad, defensive, going backward a little bit.
Pendleton missing with the right. Again, looking to taunt Trinidad, which is a mistake. It's going to take an awful lot to get a guy like Felix Trinidad out of his concentration, his focus, his game plan. He may look loosey-goosey coming in.
Great!
But he's all business when the bell sounds.
Yeah, Felix is all business, and Freddie's trying to do whatever he can to fluster him up a little bit, but it's not working.
Trinidad missing with that straight right, connecting with the left, but it was a low blow. Richard Steele says to Trinidad, get the blows up.
I'll tell you what, that hook was pretty good. It was a nice, what we call rocking right hand. He countered, he rocked out and fired right in. Hit Trinidad square in the button. Nice combination.
Again, the lunging right by fearless Freddie Pendleton, tied up by Trinidad. Trinidad 28-0 with 24 knockouts, his ninth title defense.
Nice left hook to the body by Trinidad.
A 33-year-old Pendleton, 40-20-4 with 28 knockouts. His sixth world title fight. Former IBF lightweight champion.
Great. Step back. Eight.
Wrestling tactics there at Pendleton.
Both fighters are fairly quick on the inside to tie the other one up. They don't really want to work. They see Trinidad right on top. Pendleton's next. So
keep it clean. Keep
both
it clean.
Fighters pretty quick to grab on.
Richard Steele trying Trinidad. Keep it clean. Trinidad, tremendous puncher with either hand. Also a good boxer. Has been known, as mentioned, to take his time getting started, but a terrific finisher when he gets his opponent in trouble. Seen him start slowly. Uppercut, right uppercut by Trinidad.
A nice left hook counter by Pendleton. That combination was almost an even exchange.
Break, step back.
Final seconds of round three for the IBF welterweight title. There's the bell. Let's go over to the fight, Dr. Bernie Pacheco, with the former featherweight champion, Aloy Rojas. Doc?
All right, disappointed, and are you going to retire? ¿Te vas a retirar?
Sí, sí, efectivamente, ya yo tenía planeado, en caso de ganar esta pelea, unificar con Tom Johnson, posteriormente retirarme.
All right, he was planning to fight Boom Boom and then retire, but now he's going to retire definitely. Tú estabas enfrente, you were ahead on the cards. Did you expect that knockout so resoundingly? ¿Te sorprendió el knockout?
Mira, exactamente, tuve indicaciones de la esquina que la pelea estaba pequeña. Cuando yo tenía ciertas dudas también de que yo estaba ganando, por supuesto, ¿no? La esquina me mandó a pelear, a presionar un poco más para sacar un poco más de ventaja. Bueno, y ustedes saben el resultado, pero es un resultado lamentable para mi carrera. Pero en todo caso, todo trae algo positivo. Pues en este caso es el retiro, es una carrera de alto riesgo donde se pone la vida.
All right, I have to cut him off. He is sorry that he lost, but he couldn't help it.
All right, Purdy. So in a stunning upset, stunning because one judge didn't have him winning a single round. The other two had him behind by comfortable margins. Wilfredo Vasquez stopping Eloy Rojas in the 11th round for the WBA featherweight championship. Here we are in the IBF welterweight championship, fight round four.
Well, I thought Rojas was way ahead myself, but you know, 10 or 10 and a half rounds was not a fight make.
As we discovered, Pendleton still standing in front of Trinidad, a dangerous strategy. Trinidad's a worker. He'll put punches together.
That was south.
Keep it up. You're holding him down, okay? Keep him up.
Richard Steele does the cautioning. Pendleton looking to dig to the body. Wild swing and a miss with a left hook by a fearless Freddie Pendleton.
That's the second warning for low blows given by Richard Steele to Felix Trinidad. A couple of those hooks just going a little south of the border.
Usually Trinidad makes his opponent pay when they miss. We'll see what happens here.
The action heating up a little bit from before I left. They were just kind of patsying when I left. They're down to business now.
Trinidad, Bobby, a very good counterpuncher.
Bobby, who won the last round? I was gone.
The last round was also won by Trinidad, but again, the margins are very, very slim. Not winning by a lot. What we saw in the last round, Purdy, Pendleton started to come forward, as he's doing now. He's starting to come forward. Trinidad, not necessarily pressing issue all the time.
Round four continues. A left hook there by Pendleton.
Keep him up, Freddie. Keep him up.
Let's fly with a straight right hand. Pendleton opening things up here a bit.
He's taking his chances, this Pendleton.
He's coming straight forward, pouring in on Felix Trinidad.
Freddie's done some nice work.
Oh, right speed.
And counters just like that right hand, Steve.
Beautiful straight right by Freddie Pendleton.
Freddie throwing everything he's got on those punches. He's trying to hit a home run.
He tagged him with another right. But unfortunately for Pendleton, Trinidad was moving backward.
Well, I know he got Tito's attention, that I'm sure.
Yeah, all of a sudden, Trinidad looking a lot more intense than before. Combination by Trinidad.
And a nice punch underneath, even though it was low.
It was low. Richard Steele did not see it. Now, here comes Trinidad.
Pendleton gave me the impression a little bit that he might be a little hurt. His legs didn't look under him, but I haven't seen any really clean blows.
Well, that was a body shot, and I think he little caved in a little bit. Not much, but that's the first indication.
Heading for the bell. Round four is over.
Tranquilo. Tranquilo. Muy joya, pai. Muy joya. Muy joya. Muy bien. Muy bien.
Con cara. Respirando por la nariz.
Respirando por la nariz.
Muy joya. Listo. Él está atrás. Ya está atrás. Él va a salir ahora a buscar un golpe de suerte.
Ok.
Óyeme lo que te estoy diciendo. Él va a salir ahora con un golpe de suerte. Manténlo a raya por lo menos un minuto. ¿Me entiendes? Pero poniéndole presión. La presión, que no me le quite la presión.
He said you're ahead in every round, but now he's going to come out looking for you. He's going to look for that body blow. Come right on top when he comes in with a body blow.
Well, here you see a low blow, too. You know, he just takes him, he digs him up, and just throws it south.
Yeah,
Freddie pulled his head down, but he just let it go, and it went loud.
Yeah, he did. But Pendleton comes back fighting. I mean, you know, this was a good round, the best round for Pendleton, because he's trying so hard to land that right hand, and he did a couple of times. He caught Tito's attention, I'll say that.
A little more sense of urgency in that Trinidad corner as we head into round number five. Peddled his corner, yelling at him to go to the body and counterpunch between rounds. Round four was Peddled's best round yet.
You know, he landed some really big bombs there. I gave him an even round.
I did too.
Right north toward the end, Cheeto started to take over the round. And let's see what happens now when round five starts.
Get a little taunting there by Peddle in his Trinidad with a little head fake, little stutter step, but he hasn't thrown. He's waiting. There it is. A lunging straight right by Trinidad.
He tries to go right over the jab if he can. Trinidad's got trigger fast reflexes, which is what all great fighters have to have. I mean, when he's in front of you, it's like a spring. Oh, nice uppercut.
The right uppercut by Trinidad, twisting.
Watch your head. Great. Watch your head.
Watch your steel. Doesn't want any cuts. No headbutts here. No technicalities. Trinidad, very confident.
Freddie Pendleton pulls away on that right hand very well. He, like, rolls with that punch, minimizing the power. And he's got to stay at that range.
Trinidad bobbing and waving, looking for the opening. Very patient.
But Bobby, that punch is getting closer and closer.
Before Pendleton went down, he went back to the corner as if something was wrong, and he shook his head. Got hit with a left hand. He's not getting up.
He looked over the corner. He goes down, and it's over. It's over here in round five. Felix Trinidad retains his title.
Another questionable finish. It's a strange finish. What was that?
He looked at the corner. He went to the, over to the corner, looking almost directly at us, because where his corner is here, and shook his head no, and had a distressed look on his face. And he shook his head no, and I went to myself.
And he hit one body shot hit him. He must have, you know, a broken rib or some kind of pain to him, because I didn't see any damage to him that occasioned that.
Prior to this, no, I didn't see it.
What a powerful left hook to the body of Freddie Pendleton. I can't wait till you get to talk to him to find out.
I hope we get to talk to Pendleton, because that requires an explanation. Let's see if we can see anything, Bobby, in a replay that we didn't see here with the naked eye, because it sure went by me. Yep. Let's take the first look at it and see if we can see what Bobby was talking about when he was just looking. Now, this is already in the corner, and there's the hook underneath. Now, that's not enough to drop
him. No, it's not enough to keep him down for 10. Something else had to be wrong. Yeah. I don't know what, though.
Well, it could have been
if we had your tape roll back further, at the angle we saw the fight at, he just went back to that corner and he looked distressed.
Right, where he hit him is right at the bottom of the rib cage there. If he has a cracked rib there, it hurts. But when if it's true, what you saw, if it's true, when he came through here and looked at his corner, he must have already been hurt.
I saw something in his eyes in the last round.
It almost looked, Bobby.
But I saw something in his eyes in the last round. We'll watch. You see, he's looking away and he's shaking his head no, like something's wrong. And he sits there and he gets hit. And it was a very clean left hook, but you can see him shaking his head toward his corner.
And did it look like he was going down even before the punch?
Yeah, it looked like the very next thing that was thrown, he was going to go down with. That's what it looked like.
I'm confused.
So, a bizarre ending here to the fifth round. A lot of chatter going on in that Trinidad corner as he retains his IBF welterweight championship. And he goes to 29-0 with 25 knockouts. 23-year-old Felix Trinidad retaining a title he has now held for nearly 3 years. Ninth successful defense of the crown. His unblemished record swelling to 29-0. And it ends a five-fight winning streak for Freddie Pendleton, who now drops to 40-21-4. Trinidad continues to mow him down. And now boxing fans, those who have followed his meteoric rise, wait and see what his next move is.
Come on real sudden?
What's next? Will he take on two-time world champion Frankie Randall, or will he seek to unify the welterweight title against opposition like Pernell Whitaker or Ike Forte?
Puerto Rico, lo quiero. Esta pelea especialmente para toda la madre de Puerto Rico, especialmente mi madre, Inadori, mi tía, es Rosa.
He really wants Pernell Whitaker, and he's saluting his friends and family back in Puerto Rico. Let's get the official time from our ring announcer, Jimmy Lennon Jr.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have the time of 1:30 in round number five. A referee in charge, Richard Steele, reaches the count of 10. He's the winner by way of knockout, still undefeated, and still the IBF welterweight champion of the world, Felix Pendleton.
So there you have it, the announcement of Felix Tito Trinidad retaining his IBF welterweight championship. He could also wind up fighting the winner of Julio Cesar Chavez and Oscar De La Hoya. Anything is possible. There are so many possibilities out there for Felix Trinidad. Let's take a look at some intriguing action here earlier in the round here, Bobby. Take a look. Watch Middleton's face. This is way before the end of the fight.
Yeah, you could see him looking and just shaking his head. No, I'm not sure what that could possibly be.
This is way before the knockout, keep in mind. But
I overheard something in his corner, Steve, where somebody asked him a question. He said, did it come on all of a sudden? He said, very sudden. So I'm assuming maybe something got hurt in his body that just started to be really painful for him.
He was wincing, and he, as mentioned, his backward motion, he was going down even before the punch. It was a solid punch, but perhaps not the kind of punch that would end a fight, Bobby, as you pointed out.
It just seemed that something was wrong before he got hit, and I don't know that, we're going to find out unless we talk to him.
And hopefully that is being arranged as we speak between the fight doctor and the Pendleton camp. There, he looked over to the corner, and then he went down.
He was letting them know something was wrong.
The fight doctor, Ferdy Pacheco.
Fighting out of the blue corner, wearing black. Official weight, 158 pounds. Professional record, 26 victories, including 22 knockouts, with 4 defeats and 1 draw. Damas y caballeros de Managua, Nicaragua, the former welterweight champion of the world, Ricardo El Matador. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing burgundy, official weight, 157 and 3 quarter pounds, professional record, 31 victories including 34 knockouts with only 1 defeat. He is the former welterweight, former super welterweight, and former middleweight champion of the world, Damas y Caballeros de Cupe Alto, Puerto Rico, Felix Tito
Reglas. Toquen guantes, toquen.
Vamos a ver si va a seguir hablando ahora.
Touch the glove.
Go. De La Hoya versus Hopkins didn't live up to its hype as the second coming of Hagler versus Leonard. This one might have a better chance of being a facsimile of Hagler versus Hearns.
It has taken quite some time to clear the ring, and because of all the pageantry, a great deal of time since the fighters entered the ring. In fact, Roy Jones, Ricardo Mayorga, has been in the ring for 14 minutes now before the first bell sounds. Could that be disruptive to him?
No, it won't bother him. You got to know that he's this type of guy. He's the one guy who will be ready for anything that happens tonight.
He landed a right hand over the top against Trinidad. Second right hand was a glancing blow. Trinidad hasn't really gotten off on offense. Mayorga is swinging already. Third right hand in a row. Left hook. Mayorga doesn't bother with jabs all that often. Although as the fight goes on, he'll throw some of them just to change the pace. But in round one, he likes to let you know that he's swinging for the fences.
He wants you to know that he's knocking out, but Trinidad would be very smart to use his jab early so they can see some of the things that Mayorga was trying to do to him.
Tito has a long history of being unsteady on his feet early. As we mentioned, he's been knocked down 8 times in his career. Most of them were quick knockdowns in early rounds against lesser opponents, after which he got up and knocked the guy out. Here, he looks particularly unsteady on his feet. Mayorga doing most of the throwing. Felix doing some defending, but some catching. Two body shots for Mayorga. Right hand over the top, and another. Trinidad just trying to get out of the first round and survive Mayorga's onslaught for the moment. Now Felix offers a left hand, taking advantage of a counterpunch opportunity. Mayorga looks as though he's just going to keep on coming.
Oh, he is. He's definitely going to keep coming. Good right hand by Tito.
Hard right hand lands on the button. Tito managed to take it. There's another one. What about the impact of Mayorga's punches, Roy?
They are definitely having an effect, but this is his first time at middleweight, so.
Now he takes Trinidad's left hook. And this is a Mayorga tactic. He drops his hands and says, come on, hit me. Did it with Forrest, does it here with Tito Trinidad.
He also told us it was a trick because when you can see the punches coming, you can take it.
Trinidad lands a straight right hand. And another right hand. And now Trinidad with the uppercut. Brings the left hook. Jab. Picks off Mayorga with another right hand. And now it's Mayorga who's taking the punishment.
Mayorga's tired. He don't care to wait as good as he does to welterweight division.
If Tito was waiting for Mayorga to tire, it's an effective piece of tactic as he throttles Mayorga down the stretch of round one. Mayorga didn't look good on his feet as the round came to a close.
Did anybody say Hadler Hearns?
I think so.
Give some water.
I think Bernard Hopkins made that point.
Let's go, Stevie. Don't lower your hands. Don't do that. All right, everything calm. He knows he can't take your power. You're going to get him now.
After dominating almost the entire first round, at the end of the round, Trinidad got in his licks.
Who has the psychological advantage after round one, Roy?
Trinidad does, mainly because, like I said, this guy doesn't seem to take the same punch as a middleweight as he did as a welterweight. He doesn't seem like he's in shape when he fights at middleweight. He never breathes this hard during his earlier fights at welterweight.
Trinidad was devastatingly accurate down the stretch of round one. Wound up landing 29 out of 55 punches in the round. 25 of those 29 connects in the last minute of the round. Mayorga was 19 out of 84. Interesting round to score.
Now Mayorga's bleeding at the nose, so this is definitely a confidence killer.
And Trinidad is finding the target with his left hook. So Mayorga goes to his left hook. Body, then upstairs. Perfect counter left hand by Trinidad right up the pike. Mayorga lands his left twice. Missed over the top with the right. Hard right hand by Trinidad. This time Mayorga takes it. Comes back with his own.
And Trinidad come back with his own right hand.
Two hard right hands landed by Trinidad. Mayorga seems to be getting his sea legs under him with regard to taking Trinidad's punch. Halfway through round two, and already both fighters have taken several big power shots from their opponents. There's a big left hook by Trinidad. Mayorga reaching with the right hand. Now he gets closer to throw the right. And two solid shots from Tito.
He won't keep taking the lead from Tito, I guarantee you.
After an unsteady first half of round one, Felix Trinidad clearly has warmed to the task. He's finding the target, countering effectively, picking his spots, landing when he wants to against Ricardo Mayorga. Mayorga's landing some big shots in return.
But Mayorga's definitely tired. If Tito beat his body a little bit, he'd definitely be better off in this fight.
Mayorga lands twice, the left and the right. Trinidad seems able to take Mayorga's punches now.
Straight right hand.
And another. And another. Mayorga dropping his hands. Trinidad just firing away. Big left hand by Mayorga.
Big right hand by Trinidad.
And a left. So far, it is indeed the Hagler-Hearns of the new millennium. Let's see what happens in round three.
A remarkable round for Trinidad after such a long layoff to be able to stay in there at that pace.
The jab, Tito. Yeah, you got him. Tear him up. Deep breath. You're going to kill him. Hey, you got to use the jab and raise your hand. Raise your right hand. Try the uppercut. The left hand, the left uppercut is going to do it. In the middle with the left uppercut.
Felix Trinidad has the superior technique, and in a rough, tough fight like this, perhaps that will be the difference.
He landed a very good straight right lead in that rollback that you just saw. Very effective punch for him in this fight so far, his straight right hand.
And the 36 punches that Trinidad landed by CompuBox count in the second round are the most punches ever landed against Ricardo Mayorga in a single round in any of the fights CompuBox has tracked. Now we go to round three. It's been a furious, vicious, hard-fought first two rounds, both men getting their power shots in. But if Tito Trinidad continues to land 60% of his power shots, as was the case by CompuBox count in round two, it's hard to imagine him losing it.
And that was a good jab by Tito.
One of the things I'm noticing, because we asked Trinidad whether he had learned anything from the Hopkins fight, and he said, well, one or two little changes, is that he's moving a little better from side to side. He used to be able to stand right in front of the opponents because he had such confidence in his power.
He's moving just enough to disrupt some of Mayorga's offensive onslaught. But he took that right hand, which landed right down the pike.
And he's taking Mayorga's punches very well now.
And he lands a right and a solid left hook. And Mayorga takes those punches and comes right back. Huge left hook by Mayorga. Tito walks right through it. At this moment, it's clear that Trinidad can take Mayorga's power. At least for the moment. Trinidad beginning to jab a little more often, exploring the boundaries of his technical advantage over Mayorga.
And he's smart. He's moving around the ring now. Like Larry said, he's not going right after Mayorga. He's very smart.
Little movements with the feet. A refinement in Trinidad's game.
Good shot.
Trinidad's glove touched the canvas, and there's the first knockdown of the fight. Properly ruled.
Six, seven, eight.
Trinidad does not appear to be affected by the punch.
Not much at all.
Let's see if he'll retaliate. And if Mayorga lost the first two rounds, he may have just evened the fight with that knockdown.
Yeah, but Trinidad's caught with a good left uppercut coming in, too.
Another big right hand. This time Mayorga misses over the top. Trinidad a little short with the counter. Trinidad is landing his left hand as though it's a laser.
Beautifully.
Huge right hand coming under by Mayorga. Felix swings and misses with a big left hook. A knockdown in round three for Ricardo Mayorga.
That was a slip. Don't worry, that's nothing. How you feeling? Everything fine? Don't jump around so much. Yeah. Come on, stand right in front of him and fight with him. Okay? He's looking for the knockout, but he's gonna get knocked out. He can't take your punches.
He see Mayorga go in with a left uppercut and an overhand right over the top, caught Cheeto clearly on the ear, and it knocked him pretty much off balance, but his glove did touch the canvas, so that is considered a knockdown. Once again, he came with uppercut and an overhand right over the top. It was a shot behind his ear, but since his glove touched the canvas, that is considered a knockdown.
Roy, a lot of Mayorga's punches are landing on top of the ear, around the head. How much do those punches hurt?
Those are very effective punches because you usually don't see them coming, and they just seem to do something really, really bad to your equilibrium.
Harold, how do you have it scored through three?
Okay, Jim, I think Ricardo Mayorga evened up the fight with the knockdown, even if it wasn't such a great knockdown. 28-28 in rounds, two rounds to one, Felix Trinidad. I thought Trinidad in rounds one and two kept them beautifully at the end of that long reach, just like he's doing now, and having it. Mayorga ties it up in the third round with the knockdown.
Look at the accuracy of Trinidad's straighter, shorter punches.
And he's throwing beautiful straight punches tonight.
That's his big advantage against Mayorga. In a free-swinging trade in the center of the ring, Felix's punches should get there first. But the big left hook lands for Mayorga. And now he loops another one around the guard. Trinidad nearly knocks his head off with a left hook.
Yeah, if Trinidad would just hit his body, he'd finish his fight real quick.
Neither fighter throws many body punches. Felix has done it more frequently in the past, but right now he's fighting Mayorga's fight, as almost everybody is tempted to do.
Mayorga's dead tired, though.
Well, I was about to ask you if maybe Trinidad is getting tired, because he limited himself to only throwing 13 power punches in round three, a round in which Mayorga threw 43 of them. Felix is boxing more than we might have expected at this point in the fight. Big left hook by Mayorga.
And he's boxing very smartly here.
Big uppercut by Trinidad. Boy, Mayorga's got a beard and a half.
But he's dead tired, Jim. One body shot from Felix will really, really help him out.
When a guy has as much power as Trinidad has had over his career, he tends to become a headhunter.
That's not bad because he's landed some beautiful head shots tonight, but I mean, he can make it easier on himself if he goes to the body.
Is the 2.5-year layoff potentially a factor in his not remembering to throw the body shots?
No, he wasn't throwing body shots before he laid off.
All right. Can this fight go on at this pace for how long, and who gets affected first?
Mayorga would not last as long. All Tito has to do is not get caught by a surprisingly big shot, and he'll stop Mayorga later on in this fight. Mayorga's dead tired. Tito will remember sooner or later to go to the body.
And Mayorga already is losing power on his wide swinging shots, while Tito is mustering power on his straighter, shorter punches.
And Mayorga does not like this weight either. He doesn't fight well.
There's a body punch, and it hurt Mayorga back.
I told you.
And he comes back with an uppercut.
But he's dead tired.
It's Mayorga's instinct to fight when he's hurt. And that's why he came out swinging after Felix touched him up with the body punch.
This is one of the most amazing fights we've seen in a long time for fighters who are at the elite level of the sport.
But as they go to their corners, Roy Jones' observation is quite apt. Mayorga was exhausted before he sat on the stool.
Ricky, come on, champion. Relax. You gotta relax a little bit more.
You got to be able to get rid of those punches a little bit. You got to be a little more relaxed. You got to use the 1-2 and then the left uppercut. The uppercut.
Here you see Tito coming to right handy, and now he throws the left liver shot, which we wish he'd been throwing earlier. And you can tell that shot hurt Mayorga. He pulled the arm down right to the spot and immediately backed out of the scene.
By and large, Roy, isn't it fair to say that body punches will hurt you more than head punches when properly landed?
Yes, they will, and they last for a longer period of time.
Power shots in round four, according to CompuBox. Trinidad, 20 out of 34. Again, 60%. Mayorga swung away for 52 power shots, but landed 20, 38%. Mayorga's losing a little steam on his punches. Trinidad is still throwing them short and straight.
Mayorga's not the same fighter at this weight as he is at 147, without a doubt. Game.
Of Trinidad's 34 knockouts in his career, 30 were within five rounds. That's typical of most power punchers who get to their lesser opponents in a hurry. This opponent isn't as lesser as many others, but he's getting hit a lot.
But you don't see Trinidad rushing in trying to finish him, though, because he knows he's dangerous once he's hurt.
Great counter right-hand punch by Trinidad, stopping Mayorga in his tracks. Mayorga starting to back up now.
Trinidad now senses that Mayorga is ready to be taken, but Mayorga may have some other ideas.
Mayorga's exhaustion marked by the fact that he stood still momentarily against the ropes. Trinidad hit him with two straight right hands. Now they're trading again at center ring. Trinidad's activity level is going up, and Mayorga's is coming down.
Yeah, because Mayorga's tired. Like I said, he's not the same fighter at middleweight as he is at 47. But if Trinidad goes back to his fight a couple more times, he'll get this fight over with.
You get the sense that if Mayorga was knocked down on the canvas, he'd beat the canvas.
He's definitely exhausted right now. Steam is about going out of his punches.
You wonder when Trinidad's going to go back to the body. He did so much damage with that one left-hand shot. Good left hook upstairs by Trinidad. But for a guy who's been away 2.5 years, he is sharp with counter punches.
He looks good. Looks very good for 2 years later.
Mayorga backing up, taking straight punches. Trinidad very selective, incredibly accurate. The accuracy with power punches is something amazing to behold. He's ripping Mayorga. Huge left hook. And now Mayorga begins to hold. A sure sign that he's taking more punishment than he wants. 10 seconds to go in the round as Trinidad corners his man and tries to finish. Huge cut under Mayorga's left eye.
19,000 people on their feet.
What a fight.
Let the doctor in. Give me a doctor.
Ring doctor coming into the corner to look at Mayorga.
Take some air. Take some air now. Deep breath. You can't be taking those punches. You've got to be a little more. Use the 1-2. Come on. Make sure you're strong and throw some punches.
And here's that left uppercut that Trinidad has been landing all night long. Mayorga cannot do nothing with that shot. There's that right hand. Trinidad looks so sharp and crisp with his combination tonight.
I don't know too many fighters who could have stood up to that barrage.
I don't know if I've ever seen a more accurate display of power punching in one round. Felix Trinidad was incredible in round five. And he's smiling and he's flexing his right arm as if to say, I'm the one who's got the power here. And Mayorga is in trouble as we go to the sixth.
Big trouble.
Ricardo Mayorga has just experienced the roughest round of his career. Trinidad landing the most punches and the most power punches ever landed against Mayorga in a contract round. And you can see how badly Trinidad has damaged the area under Mayorga's left eye.
Good straight right lead by Trinidad.
Again, notice how he's using his legs going from one side of Mayorga to another. Roy, he's really had worked on something in these 2.5 years.
Yes, he has.
Trinidad has weathered the early storm. If Mayorga can continue to stand up under the barrage, the question then becomes, will he get a second wind of some sort? He hammers Trinidad with a right hand. Felix comes back with a big left.
That was a good trade. Yeah, he'll be gone soon, though. He's dead tired, Jim. There he is. He won't last much longer, I guarantee you.
Big left hook by Trinidad. Mayorga really feeling the effects of his punches.
Yeah, he won't last much longer. He's really gone now. A couple of shots to end this.
It looks like almost he can't hold his right hand hot to protect against those left hands.
He can't. That body shot got real.
Mayorga has never been on the canvas.
Yeah, he's going tonight.
He took a TKO in his pro debut, accumulated punishment. And he's still standing here, but the accumulation of punishment is ongoing once again.
Smoger's thinking about stopping it himself. He's looking at it very close now.
Smoger will let a fight go as long as he sees a chance for the fighter taking the punishment, as long as the fighter is fighting back.
Smoger will let a fight go about as much as any referee we've seen.
Oh, that was a body shot that hurt him.
Mayorga is saying he got hit on the hip.
It looked that way, Jim.
And now there's an injury timeout. Trinidad has a long history of low blows.
That can help Mayorga because he can take as much as 5 minutes.
That won't help him because he's on the downside of this fight.
On the hip.
Is Mayorga acting to establish the effect of the punch?
I don't think he's necessarily acting. I'd like to see the punch again to see if it was low, but it won't happen none because he is in a world of trouble here tonight.
And that left eye closing fast. Here's another look.
Oh, yeah, there's a low blow.
We're on a 5 minute clock.
We're on a 5 minute clock, according to referee Steve Smoger, as Mayorga gets a chance to recover from the low blow.
But for Mayorga, I think this hurts his eye, too, because now his eye gets a chance to swell even more.
Without the cut man getting a chance to work on it with the in-swell.
Exactly.
The time off would be a lot different if the cut man could be at work. Instead, the eye just keeps on swelling.
I don't think he really wants a lot more, Jim.
He looks discouraged, and you don't often see Ricardo Mayorga with a discouraged look on his face.
But he's decided to come back before the 5 minutes are up. You may have to kill him to beat him.
Well, Tito's definitely trying to do that.
It looks as though Mayorga is going to make it out of round six. But Trinidad now has some extra rest to fuel his fire for the seven.
Good combination.
Oh, big left hook by Mayorga. Two right hands. And a body shot. And another right hand. And they trade shots after the bell.
I'll tell you what, I'll take it on my war team any day of the week.
There was a body shot in there that made Trinidad step back for a moment.
Take some water. Come on, water. Hey, when you go to, you gotta be first. Yeah. Don't let him take the initiative. You be first. Hey, Tito, the right hand, that's the power. That's it, the straight right hand. That's a good one. We got him now, we hurt him. You got him, sting him real good.
Another left uppercut by Tito. It was a grazing shot, but it was one of the same shots, boom, that leads to the left hook. And I think that shot truly hurt me.
How can you tell?
Again in the
because
sixth round. A Again, in the sixth round, Trinidad landed more than 60% of his power shots. What an amazing display of accurate power punching so far. Harold Lederman, how do you have it through six?
Okay, Jim. 5 rounds to 1, 58-54, Tito Trinidad. Jim, in that round five, he won it so big. I tell you, if a judge doesn't score that 10-8, I don't know when a judge will ever score a 10-8. So anyway, that'll make up for the knockdown. 58-54, 5-1, Trinidad.
Arguing that Trinidad's holding him behind his head. Now he lands a big right hand, another chopping right hand. The guy has a heart as big as Nicaragua.
Yes, he does. I'll tell you, he definitely could go to war with me any day of the week.
Hard right hand by Mayorga. Left hand is blocked. Look at him just firing away.
Right when you think he's finished, here he comes.
As the left eye closes up, Mayorga opens up again.
Well, you still think that little break didn't help Mayorga?
I don't know if it helped him or not. I don't think it helped his eye real, but
didn't hurt him.
No, it didn't hurt him.
We can agree there.
Well, more and more it appears there are two critical differences in the fight. Trinidad is a far better boxer, and Mayorga might not be a legitimate 160-pound fighter.
That's the biggest key factor here tonight. He's not a legitimate 160-pounder. But, like you said, for the right money, he'll do anything. He don't care. He fights for a living. That's simple.
He'll invite Lennox Lewis to come
back. Exactly right. Oh, good body shot.
Takes the right hand. And now Mayorga gets hit on the right side of the body again. And he thought he was going to get a low blow ruling from Smoger, and he didn't get it. And it gives Trinidad a couple free shots. And rest assured, Mayorga's going to fire back at some point. And he does.
You don't like these body shots, though, Joe. I don't know why.
What an uppercut. What a violent uppercut by Trinidad.
If he thinks he was really hit low, what he should do is hit that low.
No, he said he got hit in the back, though. He wasn't saying it was low. He said he got hit in the back.
All right. Then hit him in the back.
Right.
Huge left hook by Trinidad. Stuns Mayorga. And now Mayorga is holding on.
For dear life. Tito is showing some true condition here himself tonight, Jeff, because he's throwing a lot of big punches. And that takes a lot out of a fighter.
What a stunning fight. What an amazing 7 rounds of combat.
Come up after every round. I think we need him out of here.
Yeah, I'm here. Okay, you gotta pressure him. And if you have to hit him in the balls, hit him in the ball. Hey, if you hit him in the ball, hit him back in the ball. Yeah, this is not a playing game. If he hits you in the ball, you hit him back. You gotta be first.
It's on his butt cheek, but it's a bad shot, and he can't walk away like that, but it is a bad shot. It was low, and it was on his butt cheek.
How painful is it to get hit hard on the hip?
Very painful, especially when you're as tired as these guys should be.
I would say that Trinidad's putting on a remarkable performance, not only in the fact that he seems to be winning the fight, but that he's fighting at this level of intensity after such a long layoff.
I think there's two remarkable performances going on. Trinidad is landing 60% of his punches, which is astonishing. Mayorga has thrown 512 punches, which is almost equally as astonishing.
Trinidad is not wasting much. He's being very economical tonight.
All out attack from Mayorga.
Then he steals him a little punch on the leg.
Yeah, poke him a little there.
Just to let him know he's still here.
Body shot by Mayorga. Trinidad trying that uppercut, which has been so devastatingly accurate.
Four hooks by Mayorga.
Three left hooks.
Four. That was exceptional.
It's almost as if he's gotten his second win.
It does indeed appear that he's gotten his second win.
No. Right.
In this round, for the first time, he's not only out throwing Felix, out landing him. But there, Trinidad stops it with two straight right hands.
Oh, good hook.
Oh, what a big left hook.
There he is.
That could be the beginning of the end.
That hurt him real bad.
Mayorga not throwing at all. Trinidad looking to finish. Look at Mayorga.
Oh.
Weathering the storm again. Trinidad hits him flush with an uppercut.
Oh, that's a body shot. I told you the body shot would have done it a long time ago.
Siete. Ocho. Nueve.
Up at the count of nine.
A heart as big as Mexico.
I told you. And I told you the body shot would have finished the job a long time ago, Jim.
Desperate, Ricardo Mayorga tries to unload the arsenal against Trinidad. Trinidad comes back. Mayorga's on the canvas a second time. Never on the canvas before, twice in this round. Trinidad was all the way up on the top rope in the neutral corner. Now he has to climb back down.
I told those body shots would do it, Jim.
No pre-knockdown rule in effect. Another savage left hook by Trinidad. Mayorga goes down for the third time, and Steve Smoker is going to stop the fight.
Very smart call. Stop
the fight. Sensational knockout.
A few seconds before the ninth round.
Larry, I don't like to keep talking about the ninth round.
Two-word headline, everybody. Tito's back. In round eight, Felix Trinidad closed the show, landing, are you ready, 39 out of 47 power shots. That's what you call target practice. Knockdown number one.
He threw a left hook to the head. He came back. He threw a right uppercut. He leaned outside. He saw the body shot, so he's just going to take it. Right there. Boom. Good body shot. The shot I've been calling for all night. Knew once he landed that shot, that would be it. Here, Mayorga just hurt from an accumulation of punches and the right-hand left hook. Kind of does the deal, but he's still trying to stay up, and he went down from a very short right hand again.
Just, and then the third time, Mayorga goes down to avoid further punishment, and that was probably enough to convince Smoker that, well, he's had enough.
And at this point, I think it was pretty evident that it was over. He was tired. He had no steam on his punches. He was just making it out of the way of the punches. Then, boom, there's a right hand and left uppercut again. The left uppercut was ferocious tonight. And he just went ahead and went down to avoid further punishment.
Is there a harder puncher pound for pound in the sport than Felix Trinidad?
I really don't think it is. And that would be another exceptional fight for Bernard Hopkins. He said he wants to make an impressive 20th defense. Here he goes.
Is there a smarter finisher in the sport than Felix Trinidad?
There's not a gutsier finisher in the sport than Felix Trinidad.
He took a lot of good shots from Ricardo Mayorga and finally got Mayorga to go down three times in the eighth round, the first three times in Ricardo Mayorga's career that he's tasted the canvas, and a resounding triumph for Felix Trinidad in his first fight back after a 2.5-year layoff.
And he took a big fight, a big chance.
Let's go to Michael Buffer for the official particulars on a sensational fight.
Ladies and gentlemen, here at Madison Square Garden, the combat has begun. Referee Steve Smoker steps in and calls a halt to this contest at 2 minutes 39 seconds of round number 8. The winner by knockout victory, Damas y Caballeros de Cupe Alto, Puerto Rico, Felix Quintero.
take a look at final CompuBox numbers for one of the most devastating displays of power punching in the recent history of the sport. Felix Trinidad landing 149 more punches, throwing 104 less. Look at the connect percentage. And Mayorga, sure, he's an easy target because his arms are wide and free and he's swinging, but you got to step up inside of all that to land those punches.
Yes, you do. That is for sure. Cheeto showed tonight what a little bit of rest can do for a good fighter.
Look at the power punch statistics. 218 out of 329. This is after a 2.5-year layoff against an opponent regarded as maybe the most dangerous opponent Trinidad could possibly have been in against in this situation. He lands 90 more power punches. He throws 62 less, selecting the ones that gave him a chance to land 2/3 of his power shots. Virtually incredible. Larry Merchant stands by with Felix Trinidad.
Thank you very much, Jim. Congratulations, Tito. Have you ever been in that sort of a long, tough, hard firefight?
Estando tú en una pelea así larga y fuerte y difícil. Anterior, ¿has estado en otra pelea tan fuerte como esta?
Sí, he estado en peleas anteriores fuertes y gracias a Dios pues nuevamente otra pelea fuerte, pero dominé de principio a fin.
Yeah, I've been in tough long wars before and but I dominated this fight.
Were you surprised that he was able to take so many of your big punches?
¿Te sorprendió que él pudo aguantar tantos de los golpes fuertes que tú le diste?
Se sabe que era un peleador que aguanta mucho golpe. Se dejó dar de mí y aguantó los golpes, pero fue peor para él.
We know that he can take a good punch, and I get him a lot of punches, and he took a lot of my punches, but that was bad for him.
Early in the fight, he seemed to be on top of you. Were you determined to be patient so that your technique would prevail?
Temprano en la pelea, él fue agresivo y estuvo encima de ti. Tú fuiste paciente para poder esto agarrarlo más tarde, estar con calma.
Sí, ese era el plan de pelea y gracias a Dios nos salió bien todo. Mayor que un peleador fuerte.
Yeah, that was our plan. We wanted to be cool, calm, and then our plan was worked out perfectly.
Did he ever hurt you?
¿Alguna vez te hirió, te dolió?
Bueno, en realidad, la única caída, pero creo para mí que no fue caída, pero bueno, se contó y está bien, es válida.
Not really, but there was a knockdown, which wasn't really a knockdown, but it was called a knockdown, so it was legit.
You hit him many shots right on the head, but it seemed that the one shot you landed in the body was the beginning of the end. Did you see that coming?
Tú le diste muchos golpes en la cabeza, y de todos esos golpes que en la cabeza casi no le hacía nada, pero cuando le pegaste al cuerpo, ese fue el golpe. ¿Sabías tú que lo había dañado en eso?
Sí, en realidad, pues, la esquina me envió a que le pegara el cuerpo, y así lo hice. Un peleador lastimado abajo, le das arriba y se acaba.
My corner told me to go to the body, and that's what I did, because I know that a body shot will hurt you.
It surprised a lot of people that you were able to fight at such an intense pace after a 2.5-year layoff. Did you ever feel that this was just sprinting instead of running a marathon, which you have done?
Le sorprendió a mucha gente que tú pudiste sostener una pelea como la hiciste, pero es como tú, un atleta que eres, que en sprint, tú sabías que podías mantener ese ritmo.
Sí, sabía que podía mantener el ritmo, y gracias a Dios, a mi disciplina, puedo hacer lo que hice.
Yeah, I knew that I can keep that pace up, and thanks to my discipline, I did what I did.
Were you a different fighter after 2.5 years away than you were when you fought Hopkins, and in what way?
Eres tú un peleador diferente después de 2 años y medio de tu retiro, de cuando peleaste con Hopkins, y si es así, ¿en qué forma?
Bueno, en realidad, pues, practicamos bastante el boxeo, llavear, moverme hacia los lados, y soy un peleador completo. Diferente y completo.
We practiced a lot. We went for the techniques, the bobbing and weaving, moving side to side. I'm a complete fighter.
Who does this complete fighter prefer to fight next? Would you want to get revenge against Bernard Hopkins, or would you want to get presumably the biggest money against Oscar De La Hoya?
¿Con quién quisiera este boxeador completo pelear próximamente? ¿Quisieras una venganza contra Hopkins o quisieras más dinero y pelear con Oscar De La Hoya?
Bueno, en realidad, y como le dije, he dicho anteriormente, voy a ir a reunirme con Don King y le diré qué es lo próximo para mí. El que venga, yo le voy a ganar.
Like I said before, we're going to get together with Don King, and whoever it is, we'll let you know.
Thank you, and congratulations again, Tito.
Can I send a message, por favor, si
puedo? Yeah, he wants to send a message.
Quiero enviar un mensaje a toda mi familia allá en Puerto Rico.
Family in Puerto Rico.
Quiero también enviar un saludo a toda la gente de Florida que están viendo esta pelea, a todos ustedes.
All the people in Florida that are watching this fight.
Y por último, enviarle un saludo a toda mi gente de San Tomás, Ángel.
And then all the people in St. Thomas,
a Roberto y a Julian Jackson.
And Julian Jackson. Angel also.
Thank you very much, Tito, again.
Saludo, Diepa. Saludo, Diepa, también a ti.
All right, and here's a look at Ricardo Mayorga, who elected to leave the ring without being interviewed by our Larry Merchant. Mayorga disappointed and perhaps a bit battered after taking all those punches from Trinidad. Perhaps an intelligent choice to just move on back to the locker room where doctors will examine him. After all, what do you say? Well, you heard Larry Merchant asking Tito the critical question about a potential rematch with Bernard Hopkins 3 years ago, Roy. Tito did not seem big enough or good enough to box with Bernard Hopkins. Could it be different now?
Yes, it could be different now. The layoff did him good. It recharged his body, gave him a chance to regroup, get himself back together. It's very difficult to stay at the top of this game and maintain for so many years without giving yourself a break. People don't realize when you're on top of your game, you got to be on top of your game. You don't get time to rest. So when he fell to Hopkins, he went and took some time out and rested, got himself back together. Tonight, he looks better than I've seen him in the last 6 years, I think.
And how amazing is that in light of the 2.5-year layoff?
That's really very amazing, but it goes to show you that the layoff was something that was a necessity for Trinidad. So that shows fighters that sometimes you got to lay off and give yourself a break. You can't go at that constant pace and just continuously go and go and go. You kill yourself.
And if all of this should lead ultimately to a second battle between Hopkins and Trinidad, certainly Larry Merchant, Trinidad gave Bernard something to think about with the display of greater boxing skills in the second half of this fight.
Jim, the only near parallel I can draw to what Tito did tonight is that he retired at the age of 29 of his own accord, which is almost unprecedented in boxing, and came back 2.5 years later and showed that he may have many of his best, biggest fights still ahead of him. Sugar Ray Robinson at the age of 31 took a couple of years off, hoping to become an entertainer, came back and had many of the great fights of his career. So while other giants are retiring and defeated, it looks like Tito will be here for a while to give us more thrills and spills.
The stars have been retiring or falling. Lennox Lewis said goodbye to the sport. Tito Trinidad for a while was gone. Oscar De La Hoya got knocked out by Bernard Hopkins. Roy Jones got knocked out twice. The adulation you heard and felt in this arena tonight suggested the degree to which boxing may need Felix Trinidad to come back and be great. He rose. He rose dramatically to this occasion. And Bob Costas, I know the Ryder Cup is exciting, but this was really something, wasn't it?